Well, we're going to continue and end my little series on grace, focusing on the story of Mephibosheth. And it's not an easy name to say, actually. Last month, in February, we brought some things out of the story of Mephibosheth. There's a couple more that I want to bring out. Please turn with me to 2 Samuel. 2 Samuel chapter 9 is where we find this story, but I want to give you a little bit of a recap from last month. And basically, 2 Samuel chapter 4, what we find is that King Saul and his son Prince Jonathan are dead. They died in battle. And so the house of Saul is very panicked and nervous because it is customary that the new king will eliminate the family of the old king, so there's no one that can claim the throne. So in their panic, they collect as much as they can. They scoop up young Mephibosheth, who's 5 years old, according there to chapter 4 of the second part of Samuel. And somehow in that transition of getting him out of there, heading over to Lo-Debar, he falls and he shatters something. And the Bible says that he is now lame in both of his feet. He can't walk. King David is a conquering hero. He conquers all his enemies. He moves the capital of a united Israel to Jerusalem, builds a palace. Years are passing as he's building this palace. And then he just makes a decision. He decides, I would like to show some kindness to the family of Saul. And so, he asks, is there anyone left in the family of Saul? Now, it just so happens that there is a former member of the household of Saul, a servant of Saul's, who works in the palace now with the name of Ziba. This is all now in chapter 9. And Ziba knows of one. And he goes to the king and says, there is one. His name is Mephibosheth. He is lame in both feet. He is hanging out in this desolate area, hiding from you, in this area called Lo-Debar. So that's where we take it on from there in terms of the message from last month. The recap is this, that the grace that David showed to Mephibosheth, we can see that it's very similar to the grace that God shows us. One of the things was that God's grace carries us. God's grace carries. Well, the first one actually is that God's grace pursues us. Before Mephibosheth even knew that David was going to be graceful and be so kind to him, the people were already on their way to Lo-Debar, pursuing Mephibosheth to extend this grace, this kindness that King David wants. And so God's grace pursues us too. There's not anywhere that we can go that God's grace can't find us. The second part from last month is that God's grace carries us. Now obviously, Mephibosheth can't walk, but he was brought to Jerusalem, to the palace. So it makes it pretty obvious he was carried. God's grace is no different. God's grace carries us as well when we are weak, when we need him to take over. And finally, from last month, God's grace is where we abandon our crippled past. And Mephibosheth needed to let go of his past. He needed to let go of the anger that he felt towards David. He needed to let go of the fear that he felt because he thought that David might want to kill him. He needed to let go of the insecurities and the feelings of unworthiness. In fact, in the presence of King David, he called himself a dead dog there in chapter 9. So he needed to overcome, he needed to abandon, actually, that past. And in God's grace, we can do the same. Through his forgiveness and his grace, we can let go of the past. We can let go of our anger, our bitterness, our issues, our feelings of unworthiness, and all of that. We can let go of all of that. His grace is sufficient for us. So we pick it up from there in chapter 9. And the next thing I want to mention is that God's grace is where we discover who we were born to be. It is in God's grace that we discover who we were born to be. Mephibosheth was born to be a prince. Mephibosheth was born to eventually become king. But somehow, in the journey, the death of his father, the death of his grandfather, God deciding someone else was going to be king, and anointing David king, all of that was lost. You see, we were born to be children of the King. We were born to be children of God. We were born to be in His kingdom. That is our birthright. We were born into that. But somehow, along the way, sin gets in the mix. We make bad decisions. We go all kinds of different ways. We get lost. We end up in our own little Lodabar, desolated area, where there's no sign of the King. But that's what we were born to be. And God's grace will restore us to that place. Let's take a look at how King David restored Mephibosheth. Please look at 2 Samuel chapter 9. We're going to start with verse 7. This is the part where King David gives Mephibosheth back the royal land. David says, "Don't be afraid, for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan. I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul." David just gives Mephibosheth all the land that King Saul used to control. Here you go. It's yours. The amount of land that you owned back then was huge, especially if you're a king. It was all just given back to him. Here you go. Now, it made it a lot easier that David changed the capital to this valley that he later called Jerusalem. So all that land wasn't any part of the capital or the palace anymore. But all of that, here you go, Mephibosheth, it's all yours. But not only that, he restores Mephibosheth even further. The second thing is King David makes sure that Mephibosheth is provided for. Take a look at verses 9 and 10. "Then the king summoned Ziba." That's the guy that told the king about Mephibosheth. "He summoned Ziba, Saul's steward, and said to him, 'I have given your master's grandson everything that belonged to Saul and his family. You, Ziba, and your sons," which later on in the chapter we find out there's 15 sons, okay? "You and your sons and your servants are to farm the land for him and bring in the crops so that your master's grandson may be provided for." He restores him by giving him back the land. But he sees it's not like Mephibosheth can work the land. He's lame in both feet. And it's not like he can make money in some other way to pay people to work the land. He sees that. He provides for Mephibosheth, King David does, and tells Ziba and his huge family and servants, "Go work the land. Provide for Mephibosheth." That is a major restoration of power and authority and provisions. But it doesn't stop there. King David restores Mephibosheth to the position of prince that he once had before. Verse 7 again, please. Verse 7. David says, "I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table." You will always eat at my table. Look at verse 11, the second part of verse 11. "So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons." He's restored to princehood, if that's even a word. He's restored to the position of prince, to be, again, the son of the king. So now he's got land. He's got servants working the land. He is the son of the king again. The end of chapter 9 says that he moved to Jerusalem. He was living in Jerusalem. And every night, eats at the king's table. He's a prince once again. You see, God's grace will restore us to who we're supposed to be. We just need to discover who that is. But he wants that for each and every one of us. We were born into his kingdom. We were born his children. But we make choices that move us in all different directions. His grace brings us back to who we are supposed to be. The second part that I want to bring out here is that grace is where we embrace God's favor at his son's expense. We, with God's grace, we embrace his favor, his forgiveness, all his gifts. We embrace them at his son's expense. King David showered Mephibosheth with grace. But it's not because Mephibosheth deserved it. Mephibosheth didn't do anything to earn David's grace. It wasn't because of King Saul. King Saul didn't do anything to earn that grace. Well, why was it? It was because of Jonathan. It was because of Jonathan. Jonathan, the prince, the son of King Saul. It was because of him. Think back on the relationship that he has. Let's start with the beginning of this. Okay? Jonathan is the heir to the throne. He's supposed to be the king when King Saul perishes or dies of old age or whatever. But God has other plans. God says, no, it's not going to be Jonathan. It's going to be this little guy named David, son of Jesse. Nobody knows who this guy is. He's the new king. Does Jonathan have a problem with that? No. Not only does Jonathan not have a problem with that, he defends David. King Saul gets mad at Jonathan for defending this guy who shouldn't be inheriting anything. Not only that, he protects David. He tells David what's going on. He says, David, look, I'm going to go try one more time with my dad, but, you know, if it's not looking good, I'm going to shoot this arrow and it's going to give you a signal and you may need to get out of here. You may need to flee and go into hiding. He defends David, Jonathan. And not only that, when it was clear that David needs to leave, they embrace. And Jonathan is crying at the fact that he won't be near his brother, his best friend, for a long time. Jonathan was an amazing person in the life of David. And it is because of what Jonathan did that sparked within David a desire to show kindness to the house of Saul. To show kindness to Mephibosheth, to restore him to the level of prince because of what Jonathan did. We have God's grace. It is there for us and it is merited, but we don't merit it. We don't do anything to merit God's grace. We don't deserve it. We are sinful, imperfect people, but it's not what we do that gives us that grace. It is what the prince did. The Prince of Peace, the Son of God, Emmanuel. It is what he did for us. That is how we have grace. That is how we can experience God's amazing grace. This reminds me of the story of Mephibosheth. Reminds me of the story of another individual. Good friend of mine that many of you know. His name was Caleb Acosta Franco. And I asked his parents if I could talk about him a little bit today. And thank you for allowing me to do that. His memory is not lost here among us. He went to his sleep on the 25th of March, 2014. Today is the 21st, just a few days before. And I think it's appropriate because it's been a year, but also because Caleb's testimony matches so well with the story of Mephibosheth. So I want to share with you just some small parts of his testimony that's so powerful. I have shared this testimony so many times when I do weeks of prayer at other schools, when I'm asked to speak in other places, it comes up a lot. because he had a major impact on my life. And I want to share his testimony with others. And many of you have heard his testimony when he gave it here. If you haven't, just request it. There's DVD requests. You just fill out the little folder. Just put Caleb's sermon or testimony. We'll know what it is if you haven't heard it. If you haven't heard it in a while, it's powerful. I want to share a little bit of it with you today because I think it parallels Mephibosheth so much. It was the summer of 2013, and Caleb was in Puerto Rico at a Seventh-day Adventist camp. And he had had, according to Kathy, some migraines before and some things, and just give him some Tylenol and let him be on his way. But that particular day, the headache and the pressure was so bad that he was vomiting. And he rested some, and he was able to stay there that week at the camp, but that was a signal right there. And a week later, on Sabbath here at this church, the pain was so unbearable, the migraine was so major, the nausea was there, that he went into the men's bathroom and all the stalls were taken. When does that ever happen in a men's bathroom? Women wait in lines at stadiums. Guys are just, I'm going in, you know. He had to wait. So he laid on the leather couch and fell asleep, which is very unlike Caleb. And that afternoon they went to grandma and grandpa's house, and usually when he goes to the grandparents' house, he's active and awake and doing all kinds of stuff, but that day he slept for like 4 hours or more. Very unlike him, and that signaled to mom and dad that something's not quite right. They took him in for a CT scan, and afterwards dad took the boys to SeaWorld. And the results came back. There's something there. We don't know what it is. It could be a tumor. It could be an aneurysm. We need to do an MRI. So they brought him back, did the MRI. There was a tumor. Not sure if it's malignant, but it's definitely there. That night he was admitted into the hospital, and not too much longer after that, he was scheduled for surgery on that Monday morning. He didn't end up getting the surgery that day, but it's still something worth talking about because he was scared, he was nervous, he was crying some, and I remember being there visiting with him, the family's there, and they're praying together, and they gave him what he calls the happy juice, which calmed him down. And they gave him the anesthesia, and they said, we're going to count to 10, and they got to 9, and when they got to 9, he blinked. And when his eyes opened, he was in a different room, asking the nurse, so when is the surgery going to happen? And that's when his mother, Kathy, told him, you've been out for like 8 hours. What a wonderful teaching moment. Caleb learned a lot that day. Out for 8 hours, but it was like the blink of an eye. Like the blink of an eye. The next day, they scheduled the surgery for real. This time they were going to do it. He was a little calmer, but he was still scared, a little nervous. And, well, they took him in, they gave him the happy juice. Mom and Dad said that he was so full of love. He was telling everybody, te amo, I love you. And as a parent, you probably get a little nervous with that, right? As he's saying his goodbyes, I think he mentioned in his testimony. The hospital staff prayed with him. They started counting to 10. They got to 3, but this time was different. The day before, got the same anesthesia, the same situation. He was out like a blink. He knew nothing for 8 hours, but this time was different. And this is so powerful in his testimony and for me and for those who hear this. And most of you have heard this before, but I just want to share it because it's just so awesome that he hits 3 and they shaved his head a little bit more and he's hovering and seeing this, and then everything goes white and he's standing and there's this tall figure beside him, and he looks and he asks, who are you? And the person identifies themselves, I'm Jesus. And I found it quite funny when Caleb said that his reaction to that statement was, uh-oh, I guess they messed up the surgery. I guess I'm dead. This is it. And so he asked Jesus about that And the Son of God said to him in this dream, "No, you're having a vision." And they kept walking and talking, and at one point Caleb starts just confessing his sins to Jesus. And Jesus says something that I know that we all want to hear, something that that paralyzed man heard when he was dropped from that ceiling. Jesus said to Caleb, "Your sins are forgiven." Talk about grace. And they continued on their walk, but eventually he was alone, and he looks up and he sees this golden throne and this huge figure on the throne. And to his right is Jesus, and to his left is this bird-like thing that he knew. Caleb knew was the Holy Spirit. And his response to that was an immediate kneeling down in the presence of God. And again, he started to confess his sins. And again, God the Father this time tells him, "Your sins are forgiven." Beautiful. They continue a conversation there. And when it was that time, God tells Caleb, "You're going to wake up soon. But just remember, everything is going to be okay. Everything is going to be okay." And that was Caleb's testimony and message to anyone who would listen. That he said here, that he said at Forsyth Academy, that he said to anyone who would listen, "Everything is going to be okay. God told me so. I believe it. It is true." That no matter what you're going through, whether it's cancer or disease, illness, whatever it might be, stress, anything that you might be going through, God tells me and he tells you that everything is going to be okay. Amazing testimony. The thing is, this is the part that gets me the most. I mean, the dream is beautiful. To have that experience, to have that vision with the Son of God, with the Prince of Peace, with our Creator God. But this is the part that hits me the most. That after that dream, after that moment, this 15-year-old young man, he got it. He got it. He understood it. He realized what many of us never realize. Because things didn't get better. Things got so much worse. The chemo, the radiation, the loss of appetite. And then one day, his legs just aren't working like they used to. He loses sensation in his lower extremities. He can't move his legs. They take him in, they do an MRI, and then mom eventually has to go to her firstborn son and give him the bad news. The tumor up here, it's back. Even though they took it out in the surgery, it's back. And not only that, now you have tumors and cancerous growth on your spinal cord, and that's what's causing this compression that is not allowing you to use your legs like you used to. More surgery, Caleb. More chemo and radiation. That's what gets me. Because this 15-year-old young man had every excuse to say, "Forget about this." He had every... Who would blame him? Seriously, who would blame him? He had every excuse to lose faith. He had every excuse to lose hope. He had every excuse to just give up on life. He had every excuse to be angry at God. Mom comes and tells him. And what does he do? He shrugs his shoulders. And if I remember correctly, he said, "Mom, I'm going to heaven." Everything is going to be okay. He gets it. God's grace, no no matter where we are, no matter what we're doing, no matter what path we are on, there is forgiveness, there is grace, there is that unmerited favor, but it is merited because of the Prince of Peace, because the Son and what He did. And it comes to us, it pursues us, it carries us. And that 15-year-old young man, Caleb, he understood more than anyone that I have ever met. The similarities with Mephibosheth are amazing. God's grace pursued Caleb like it pursued Mephibosheth. When he was in that camp, that summer camp in Puerto Rico, he didn't know he had cancer. He didn't know that he had all these issues and tumors in his brain. He didn't know any of that. All he knew, he had a migraine every now and then, and the nauseous, whatever, I'll tough it out. He didn't know, but yet that week, his boys with his counselor or the drama leader or whatever, they had this little skit and they're there, and I don't know if it was before the performance or after, but they're there and they're in a circle and they're praying, and they all feel this wind, this breeze around them. And when the prayer is over, the leader said, did you guys feel that? Did you feel that wind? Did you feel that breeze? And I was like, yeah, yeah. And later on, he informed them, I believe that was the Holy Spirit. You know what? I believe that too. Because God's grace pursues us. Mephibosheth had no idea what was about to happen to him. But David's grace was pursuing him. Caleb had no idea what was coming. But God's grace was pursuing him, and God's grace pursues every single one of us here today. No matter where we're at, God is after us. He wants us with him. God's grace carried Caleb. Mephibosheth had 2 feet that were lame. Eventually, Caleb had 2 legs that he couldn't use very well. But God's grace carried him. Carried him through the struggle, carried him through all of the pain and the anguish and the sorrow and all of it, the radiation and the chemo and the bad news and more bad news and more bad news. And yet this 15-year-old young man, his faith strengthens during all of this. It is because God's grace was carrying him. Carrying him, and he will do that for us as well. Are you weak? Are you sad? Do you feel like you can't do it anymore? Life is just not worth living? Do not worry. Go to your Savior. His grace will carry us. His grace is sufficient for all of us. God's grace allowed Caleb to move past his past, to abandon his past. Mephibosheth needed to give up all of his bitterness and anger and fear and all of that. What a beautiful vision Caleb has. That not once but twice, to God the Father and to Jesus Christ, he can confess his sins and be told, you are forgiven. And he could let go of his past, let go of all the stuff that was happening for 15 years, and those last months of his life be something so wonderful and so powerful that's growing his faith and building his faith. He said, I used to pray. Yeah, I used to pray, but now my prayers are conversational. I'm having a conversation with my Lord in prayer and in my devotionals. Because God's grace helps us, encourages us to let go of the past. God's grace restored Caleb into the kingdom. Caleb, like every one of us, like Mephibosheth as well, we are born into God's kingdom. We are born children of God, but sin gets in the way. Things happen in our lives. But Caleb came back, gave his heart to the Lord like never before. And I know, I'm certain, that Caleb has begun his blink. That his eyes closed that day at Hospice of the Comforter, and it's a blink. And we don't know if it's going to be another few days, weeks, months, years, decades, centuries. We don't know when the Lord is coming back, but for Caleb, for Mephibosheth, for David, for all who have chosen to have Christ in their heart, it's a blink.
Amen.
He's part of the kingdom. Caleb's been restored, just like Mephibosheth was, to eat at the table. And it says there that David tells Mephibosheth that you will always eat at my table. Those who choose Christ, invited into their hearts, like I know that Caleb did, will always, for eternity, eat at God's table.
Yeah.
And finally, God's grace is given to us because of what the Son did. There's no doubt that Caleb believed in Jesus Christ. There's no doubt in my mind that he accepted Christ's sacrifice on the cross. There is no doubt. Because although he was a humorous young man who liked to make people laugh, especially those last 9 months, what came out of his mouth more than anything else was a love for Jesus Christ, a confidence in his grace. This is a young man who came to the throne of grace with confidence. Because he loved Jesus. And he accepted what Jesus did. And he embraced the grace of God that it was merited through what the Son of God did. We all have an opportunity. We have an opportunity every day. We have an opportunity right now to have that assurance, to accept that grace into our lives, into our hearts, to have that assurance to know. So many times I ask young people, or I ask parents, or I ask adults, are you sure? Do you know that if you die today, or if Jesus comes today, do you know if you're saved? And oftentimes I get, I don't know. And sometimes I get, I don't think so. It doesn't have to be that way. His grace is sufficient for all of us, every single one of us here, without a doubt. If a 15-year-old can get it, any one of us, we all have the same opportunity. It's just beautiful that God's amazing grace can be summed up so perfectly in the words that God gave Caleb and the words that Caleb relayed to us. God's grace can be summed up and this phrase, that everything is going to be okay.
Yeah.
Heavenly Father, thank you for the story of Mephibosheth, Lord. Thank you that King David showed him such kindness and amazing grace, Lord. And that we can learn so much about your grace through that story. It would have been awesome to be there, to witness that ourselves. But Lord, you've given us a blessing. And that is to, most of us here, we're able to interact with this young man, Caleb. And his testimony is still in our hearts and in our ears and in our minds, Lord. What a wonderful message you gave us through your servant, Caleb. That because of your grace, because of your forgiveness, because of your mercy, everything is going to be okay. Lord, I cannot wait for your second coming. I cannot wait until you come back again and resurrect everyone who has given their lives to you. And we all will be reunited and go up to heaven to always, for the rest of eternity, eat at your table. Lord, if there's anyone here right now, if there's anyone here within the sound of my voice that isn't sure, that doesn't know, that doubts whether they will be part of that day, that hasn't accepted your grace, that doesn't know that everything's going to be okay, Lord, please draw near to them and they feel your warmth right now. And they understand and realize that there's nowhere that they can hide. There's nowhere to go that your grace will not pursue. That you make it so simple, so easy. This is not a complicated thing. Whoever believes in him will have